Highbridge Audio and the Mysterious Press present Flesh and Blood by Thomas H. Cook. Read by Ray Chase. Original material copyright 1989 Thomas H. Cook. Recorded by arrangement with themysteriouspress.com LLC. Recording copyright 2014 Highbridge Company. We read in this hand how it hath healed a bitter wound. And in that, how it hath locked the door against a cry. Louise Imogen Guiney, Goosequill Papers. Chapter 1. As his eyes moved about the apartment, shifting from one cluster of party guests to another, Frank realized what a good job Karen had done with the place. He'd been living with her for well over a year now, but it seemed that he'd only just noticed the way everything fit together. The brocade sofa and softly muted oriental carpet. The thick burgundy drapes and polished antique furniture. He assumed that everything around him had some sort of name or was from some particular place. Maybe the buffet table at the end of the room was Chippendale. Maybe the carpet at his feet had been hand-woven in some remote but oddly prestigious village of the Middle East. Karen would know the name, know the place. He sometimes thought that she'd been born with such distinctions already in her mind, a refinement that was beyond him, and which he could never reach because he'd come out of a dusty rural world of hard scrabble southern farms and hand-me-down clothes. He remembered rough hands and coarse speech, hard biscuits and red-eye gravy. The taste and feel of his past never seemed to leave him. And none of the glitter of Karen's high-rise Manhattan world could ever change it. "Well, I understand that you and Karen are quite an item these days," someone said. Frank glanced up from his seat and saw a large man in a dark blue velvet coat. His long, slender fingers were wrapped so delicately around the crystal stem of his champagne glass that for an instant Frank felt like taking it from him before it slipped from his grasp. The man sat down beside Frank and offered his hand. "I'm Zachary Chapman," he said, "an old friend of Karen's." Frank nodded politely. "Nice to know you." "I've been in Europe for the past 2 years," Chapman said. "So this is the first time I've seen Karen in quite some time." He shook his head sadly. "I wrote to her when Angelica was killed, but I wasn't able to come to Atlanta for the funeral." Frank said nothing. He looked at Frank intently. "No one knows how Karen survived it." For an instant, Frank remembered the first time he'd seen Angelica's body sprawled in the little weedy field where Toffler had dropped her. He could still remember the heat of that long Atlanta summer, thick, stifling, the kind that grew around you like a choking vine. "Angelica was such a beautiful girl," Chapman added. "I met her when she was only 9, but even then she was very beautiful." Angelica's face swam into Frank's mind, her eyes staring up at him from the littered ground where they had found her body, her hair splayed out around her head like a fan of spun gold. "But then I hear," Chapman said, "her beauty was part of what killed her." "Yes," Frank told him. All around him, the other people were laughing quietly, and for a moment he felt his own mind as something entirely out of place among them, alien and detached, like something floating in their midst, yet utterly withdrawn. Within a few feet, perhaps 30 people chatted politely while they ate and drank leisurely in the spacious living room. He could hear their voices quite plainly, and yet they seemed vague, bodiless. And as he let his eyes wander from one face to the next, each seemed to blend featurelessly into the other, become a soft white haze. "And you're the man who caught her killer," Chapman said brightly. "It was my job," Frank said crisply. "Did he die?" Chapman asked. For a moment, Frank thought he meant Caleb, his partner, and he saw Toffler's hand grab for the chisel and plunge it into Caleb's back, saw Caleb tumble forward as Toffler clung to him, the chisel rising and falling again and again in the steamy air. Then he realized that Chapman was talking about Toffler. Had Toffler died? "No," he said. Chapman looked surprised. "Why not?" he asked. "The South being what it is," he smiled. "I mean, that area is not exactly known for being lenient in such things."
"Toffler was insane," Frank said dully. "At least that's what the jury thought."
Across the room and through the milling, well-dressed crowd, he could see Karen making the rounds, talking to each guest in turn, the perfect hostess. She seemed happy, unexpectedly happy, and he wondered why he found her happiness so disquieting, something he had not bargained for when he'd fallen in love with her that summer, then followed her to New York. Now her happiness made him restless and uneasy, and he yearned to return to some place where the cliffs were higher and more dangerous, where the fall was quick and clean.
"Is that what you think?" Chapman asked.
Frank turned toward him.
"Pretty much," he said.
He could see Toffler quite clearly in his mind, a blonde young man with piercing blue eyes who sat beside his lawyer, staring toward the witness stand while Frank meticulously described what he had done to Karen's sister. How he had injected her with lye until she'd finally died, and then dropped her body in a vacant lot and thrown a fistful of dirt into her beautiful dead face.
"Any chance of him getting out?"
Frank shook his head wearily.
"Not much," he said, turning his eyes back to Karen.
She was wearing a long dress of dark red silk. It was sleeveless and deep cut, and it made the most of her smooth white skin. Still, he preferred the way she'd looked the first day he'd met her, the faded jeans and spattered artist's smock, which now seemed like little more than relics from the past.
"But it could happen, couldn't it?"
"There's always a chance," Frank said, without looking at him. Karen drew the glass from her lips and laughed lightly at something the man in front of her had said. His name was Lancaster, and Karen thought a lot of his work. She hung it in the gallery she'd bought on Madison Avenue and sold it for what she told everyone were steadily increasing sums.
"I guess that's a policeman's nightmare, isn't it?" Chapman said.
Frank looked at him.
"What?"
"That someone like Angelica's murderer would get out."
"Yes.
And come after you, I mean."
"That too."
Chapman's eyes narrowed.
"And what would you do if that happened?"
"I'd kill him," Frank said. He could sense a peak rise beneath him, lift him up toward what he needed, a raw and dangerous edge.
"I'd kill him," he repeated, without a second thought.
Chapman laughed, but a little nervously.
"I don't expect that an attitude like that would get you very far among New York's finest," he said hesitantly.
"I'm not a cop anymore," Frank said. In his mind, he saw the shabby little basement office he'd rented on West 49th Street. There was a gray metal desk and a few chairs he'd picked up at the Salvation Army store only a few blocks away. There was a sofa, a telephone, and an answering machine. It was all bargain basement except for a single beautiful brass lamp, a gift from Karen, which gleamed brightly in the grayish air and made everything around it appear just a little more dreary.
"Really? What is it that you do then?"
"Private work."
"A private eye?"
"Yes."
"Well, that must be exciting," Chapman said enthusiastically. "I don't believe I've ever met a real flesh and blood private eye."
"Well, it's not all that interesting," Frank said with a dull smile. He'd tried to sign on with the New York Police Department, but after what he'd done to Toffler, beating him almost to death in his spattered little artist studio, he'd been officially marked VP, violence prone, the kiss of death as far as getting another job was concerned. So he'd finally gone through the paper chase of getting a private investigator's license, spent his last dollar on the office, and set up shop.
Not much had come in until Karen started talking him up among the smart set. After that, he'd had reasonably steady work. "So you like the work?" Chapman asked casually. "It'll do," Frank said quietly as his mind did a quick run through his cases. He'd been hired by a fancy jewelry store to catch a thieving clerk, by a wealthy Park Avenue doctor to find some dirt on a man who was suing him for malpractice, and by a matron on Central Park West whose dog had disappeared on the sheep meadow and which she suspected had been kidnapped by her malicious son. "It's not what I'm used to," he added, "but it'll do for now." Chapman looked as if he were about to start another round of questioning when a tall, slender woman sat down beside him. "Good to see you again, Zach," she said. "Are you back in New York for good?" The two of them began to chat amiably together, and Frank took the opportunity to let his eyes drift about the room again. The walls were a light pink with white trim, and Karen had decked them with paintings she'd collected over the last year. Her taste had softened a great deal since she'd moved to New York, the old somberness giving way to light pastels. Frank had watched it happen painting by painting, and it was as if Karen had decided to dull the edges of her life, to surround herself with steadily more passive colors, the sort that fought against the darker vision that he thought must still prowl about inside her head. It was her right, of course, given all that had happened to her, but something in it gnawed at him nevertheless, and he often found himself turning away from the gay street scenes and unobtrusive bowls of fruit that now watched him from every wall and made him feel faintly rancid in their midst. "This is Frank Clemons," Frank heard Chapman say suddenly. He turned toward the woman and nodded. "I'm Emalia Cavallo," the woman said. "Glad to meet you," Frank said. "Frank's a private eye," Chapman announced. Emalia looked at him wonderingly. "Really?" Frank nodded dully. The woman smiled quietly. "Well, if I ever need any detective work, I'm in the book," Frank said coolly. For a time, the three of them continued to talk together. Then Chapman and Emalia drifted away. Others came in their place, joining Frank for a little while on the sofa, then moving off into the crowd. He knew some of them, and some of them he didn't, but as the hours passed, he found that it didn't matter either way. Toward midnight, he wandered into the back bedroom and stretched out on the bed, fully clothed, his long legs dangling over the shining brass rail. He thought of Karen, still out with her guests, and then of Sheila, the ex-wife he'd left in the South. Then of that unfathomable female presence which seemed to follow him everywhere, a distant ghostly figure which the slightest touch dissolved. He was in the twilight of half-sleep when Karen finally came into the room. She sat down on the bed beside him and shook his shoulders softly. "That was less than polite, you know," she said. He rubbed his eyes with his fists. "What was?" "Coming in here while we still had guests." "I'm sorry," Frank said. "I was tired, that's all." "Was it the quality that bothered you?"
"The quality of what?"
"The guests."
"No," Frank told her. "They are fine. Your friend Chapman, he seemed like a very nice man."
Karen looked somewhat relieved. She leaned toward him, touching first his shoulder, then his neck. "Why don't you get undressed?" she said tenderly. She smiled. "I will too." He sat up slowly.
"I thought I might go out."
"It's 3 in the morning, Frank," Karen said, almost pleading. He looked at her gently.
"You know how it is."
"No, I don't, Frank," Karen said. "I've never known."
He stood up silently. "I won't be gone long."
Karen shrugged helplessly. "All right," she said. Then she quickly got to her feet, walked to the bathroom, and firmly closed the door. Behind the door, he could hear the water running for her shower. She always took showers after a party, as if the champagne and pâté had somehow gotten under her nails or into her hair. For a while, he stood in the darkness and listened hazily to the falling water until at last it stopped. Then he knew that she'd be coming out soon, that she'd have the same questioning look in her eyes. He wished that he had an answer for her, something that would explain why, in the end, he always seemed to drift away. But there was nothing to say, nothing at all. And so when he heard the door of the bathroom open, he quickly threw on his coat and rushed away. Park Avenue was almost entirely deserted, and as he headed downtown, he could feel the deep winter chill in the wind that swept down it. The isolated streets looked eerily blue and deserted in the early morning hours, as if at some time during the night a terrible alarm had sounded and everyone had fled across the bridges, filling the outer boroughs as they emptied Midtown. It was the sort of solitude he wanted, but only for a little while. And so after a time, he turned west and headed into that part of the city where the streets came alive again and stayed alive no matter what the hour. The ghostly blue gave way to garish blasts of neon light, and a steady flow of traffic moved up and down the major avenues. Along 8th Avenue, the whores leaned in tavern doors, their faces lit by the marquees of the porno theaters. While they worked the sidewalks, their pimps ran poker games or sold crack in the cheap hotels which lined the adjoining streets. It was only a 15-minute walk from the luxury condos of Park Avenue. But it was another world, teeming, immediate, a place where people still put something vital on the line. Over the last year, it had become the only part of the city in which he felt at home, and there were times when he drank alone in the dank, smelly bars or stood in the dark corners of the slum hotels or walked slowly through the gray, spectral streets, and felt such a sudden, surging love for the people who surrounded him that he wanted to gather them all into his arms and lift them up into that peculiar light their own dark lives deserved. Chapter 2
I didn't hear you come back last night, Karen said as she turned toward him. Her hair shimmered in the light that streamed in from the large bay windows at the front of the room.
I didn't want to wake you, Frank said.
He sat up and rubbed his eyes wearily.
How long were you out?
Almost dawn.
She ran her fingers up his bare arm.
Why don't you stay home today? I could have Felix handle the gallery. We could go to the park or to a movie, anything.
He shook his head. No.
She looked at him worriedly.
Frank, I'm beginning to get a little concerned about...
He stood up quickly, silencing her, and walked to the window. He could see a large blank canvas reflected in it, and a little stool and an artist's palette. They had all been resting together unmoved for several months, the colors unmixed, the canvas smooth and white.
Why don't you stay home? He said cautiously, knowing that she did not want to be reminded of it. You haven't painted anything in a long time.
Karen's body stiffened visibly.
I'm not in the mood, she said a little sharply. I'll know when I'm ready. You don't have to keep pushing me.
Frank drew back the glass door that led to the terrace and felt a cool winter breeze sweep across his body. In Atlanta, she had painted in a dark, windowless room, and he could see it very well in his mind. Spattered walls and stacked canvases, an old desk covered with sketches, a rickety wooden easel. It was a place where something happened, and in its willful disarray it had given off something he admired, a deep and unimpeachable commitment.
Well, Karen said as she got out of bed, if you don't want to stay home today, I'll go to the gallery.
She walked stiffly into the bathroom and closed the door. Once again he heard the shower. Once again he imagined the water as it flowed over her. There had been a time when the sound of it had lifted him toward a strong and furious ardor. But now he could only think of the bare canvas, the unmixed paints, and the listless life they represented, the fact that she no longer put her hands to anything that mattered. He could feel a kind of dull anger building in him at the thought of such privilege, and to choke it off, he simply did what he had always done. "I'm going to work," he said. An old woman was sleeping soundly at the bottom of the stairs when Frank got to his office. She was wrapped in a thick tangle of old clothes, worn one layer on top of another, her body serving as the only closet she had. He had found her in the same place for the last few mornings, and he'd gotten used to stepping quietly over her and then moving down the narrow brick corridor to the door of his office. By 9 in the morning, when he officially opened for business, she had already gathered her few belongings in her arms and crept silently up the cement stairs. A few days before, he had stood at the small window and watched her leave. For a few minutes, she had picked at her clothing, meticulously preening herself for the new day. And as he'd watched her, Frank had wondered at the kind of appalling personal history which had finally landed her on the streets. Whose daughter was she? Whose mother? Whose sister? What web of binding ties must have been severed for her to end up so alone? A wave of warm, musty air swept out into the corridor when Frank opened the door of his office. It was pungent and faintly sweet, as if, during the night, a strange jungle rot had eaten into everything. He held the door open to clear it out, then closed it against the outer cold. His desk sat at the back of the room, gunmetal gray and solid as a monument. Several manila folders were scattered over it, and for a time he busied himself going through them. They were the files on cases he'd completed, and for each of them he calculated the remainder of his fee, then typed up a letter asking for payment. The money usually came in full and without complaint a few days later, each check in its own monogrammed envelope. Sometimes there was even a polite little thank you note on embossed stationery. During all the time he'd been a homicide detective in Atlanta, he'd never received a formal thank you note from anyone. But from time to time he remembered now, after he'd finally tracked down and convicted the one who'd killed a mother or husband or child, after all the evidence had been presented and all the appeals exhausted, someone would walk slowly up to him in the corridor outside the courtroom and without a single word draw him into a grateful embrace. At such moments the world had seemed to open up, and he'd been able to know with an absolute certainty that he had done something good. The phone rang as he was putting the last of the folders into the green metal filing cabinet behind his desk. He picked it up immediately. "Frank Clemons," he said. "Frank." "Hello, Sheila." There was a moment of silence, and Frank could tell that she was trying to keep herself together.
"This is always the hardest time for me," she said finally.
"I know."
"You too?"
"Yes."
"She would have been 20 yesterday, Frank."
"I know."
"I went out to her grave. I took some flowers."
They had buried her in a small cemetery outside Atlanta, his daughter, Sarah, who, at 16, had walked off into the woods along the Chattahoochee River late one summer afternoon and swallowed a fistful of sleeping pills.
20, Frank," Sheila repeated. "Yes."
Sheila started to say something else but broke it off. Frank could hear her crying softly from 1,000 miles away. "Are you in Atlanta now?" he asked after a moment. Sheila cleared her throat gently.
"Yes, I just came over for a couple of days."
"Still living with your father?"
"No, I got a small apartment near the courthouse. I finished stenography school. I have a job."
"Good."
"I'm glad I left Atlanta. It was never right for me."
She'd moved back to their hometown in the Appalachian foothills of Alabama. And sometimes Frank imagined her still young and restless among their speckled granite cliffs and narrow, twisting streams. "I'm glad you moved back, Sheila," he said.
"I'm a country girl, I guess,"
Sheila said with a small, painful laugh.
"I can't believe you live in New York City now."
Frank said nothing.
"Are you happy there?"
Sheila asked tentatively.
You know me, Sheila.
I'll never get over it, Frank.
No one ever does.
But this week, it was worse than it's ever been.
Frank shook his head in the dense gray air of his office.
There's nothing to do about it.
But go on living.
Nothing else, Sheila, Frank told her.
He didn't know what she wanted from him, only that she wasn't getting it. It seemed best not to string it out.
Well, say hello to your father for me, he said.
He doesn't let me talk about you, Frank, Sheila said flatly. He doesn't let me mention your name.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Well, you know how fathers are.
Yes, I do.
There was a long pause. He could hear her breathing, almost feel her breath in his hair.
I have to go now, Sheila, he said finally.
All right, Sheila said. I'm sorry. I just wanted to...
I know.
It's the one thing we'll always have together, Frank.
Yes, Frank said as he hung up.
But he wondered what else could be said of two people who had nothing left in common but their grief. The old woman was still curled up in her swirl of ragged clothes when Frank left his office a few minutes later. Her shoulders twitched painfully as he stepped over her and moved up onto the street. It was nearly 8 in the morning, and the construction site across the street was already spewing out a deafening noise. Huge cranes lifted tons of steel girders from the trucks that lined the street, their diesel engines roaring steadily over the normal din of traffic and street cries. Within 2 years it would be completed, and a huge luxury condominium would rise over the squat brick tenements which now surrounded it. It would tower over everything, transform dilapidated candy stores into chic boutiques, festoon the adjoining streets with fancy restaurants and gourmet bakeries, line the sidewalks with limousines from 9th Avenue to Broadway. From their littered stoops, the people of the old neighborhood watched in dismay as the colossus approached them. In a little while, they would all be gone, swept away like driftwood before a tidal wave. The sidewalk along 49th Street was decked with battered metal cans and huge black garbage bags, and like everyone else, Frank had to walk down a narrow stretch of walkway to keep from wading into them. Some had already been cut open and rifled during the night by people looking for the beer and soda cans they could redeem at the local food stores for 5 cents apiece. And because of that, waves of soiled paper and rotten vegetables sometimes swept all the way to the gutter. Each morning the street looked the same, and every time he walked along it, Frank remembered the sedate, tree-lined neighborhoods of Atlanta, remembered their gently swaying dogwoods, and wondered why, compared to this, he could not stand them. At the corner of 8th Avenue and 49th Street, Frank stepped into a small deli, took a table in the back, and ordered a cup of coffee. Across the street, he could see the local liquor store, its windows crowded with bottles, and he felt the old hunger again, as he always did in the early morning. To keep it down, he glanced to the left, trying to focus his attention on something besides his need. Two men were sitting at a small table, one gray and somewhat chubby, the other young and very thin.
You think I don't know, Paulie? The older man asked resentfully. Huh? You think I don't know where it went?
The young man said nothing. He had a long ponytail of light brown hair and it swayed rhythmically across his back as he shook his head.
I'll tell you where the fuck it went, the older man cried. Up your fucking nose, that's where my goddamn money went.
The young man remained silent, his eyes averted, staring at the small glass of tomato juice that rested on the table in front of him.
What happens to you is your business, Polly, the old man said. But nobody takes me down with them, you understand?
The young man nodded slowly but did not look up. The older man took a deep breath as if to calm himself, and when he spoke again, most of the anger had left his voice.
Polly, he said, almost pleading. Polly, you gotta be so fast to keep out of this shit you can't believe it. You can't believe it, Polly.
Christ, you stop a second, it fucking buries you.
A few minutes later, Frank walked back out onto the street. The noise swept over him, hard, thundering, and for an instant he thought of the dogwoods again, so white and pink in the Atlanta spring. Nothing in his life had ever seemed more false. For a while he walked aimlessly along the avenue, glancing into the shop windows or watching the people as they lounged about or walked hurriedly by. He wanted to begin something, but he did not know what, and it struck him that he had already lived too long in a state of helpless waiting. He didn't know what he'd been waiting for, but only that when it came it would be wrapped in something else, that he wouldn't recognize it until, like a hand in the dark, it suddenly gripped him from behind. It was after 10 by the time he headed back down 49th Street toward his office. The garbage cans had been emptied by then, and the swollen black bags were gone. The old lady who slept at the foot of the stairs wasn't there anymore either. But Amelia Cavallo was.
Chapter 3. She was standing stiffly against the brick wall at the bottom of the stairs. And if it hadn't been for the pale white skin and luminous black eyes, Frank would not have recognized her. The sleek velvet dress of the night before had been replaced by a long denim skirt and matching jacket. Her hair was no longer pulled tightly along the sides of her head and gathered in a small bun at the back of her neck, but fell loosely across her shoulders. The pearl necklace was gone, along with the gold bracelets, and Frank could not help but notice that she looked better without them, less the figment of someone else's imagination.
"Good morning," she said quietly. "I took your advice. I looked you up in the book."
She noticed the faintly puzzled look in his eyes.
"My street clothes," she explained.
Then she smiled tentatively.
"You do remember me, don't you?"
"You were at the party last night," Frank said.
"That's right," she said. "Amelia Cavallo."
Frank said nothing. She looked at him with an odd, almost childlike innocence, and despite the fact that she was over 40, he thought instantly of his daughter, Sarah, of that bewildered look she'd often had as she gazed silently out the front window.
"I suppose I look as if I'm in disguise," Amelia said.
Then looked at him so strangely that for a moment Frank suspected she was precisely that, a creature hid beneath another face.
"Well, not exactly in disguise," Amelia added quickly.
She glanced toward the narrow corridor that led to his office.
"This is where you work, isn't it?"
"Yes."
"Most people get to work at 9,
she told him in a voice that was gently scolding, yet straining to be light, playful, to warm the air around them. Frank said nothing.
"It's not exactly the high-rent district, is it?" she added. "For a moment I thought I must have gotten the address wrong. You know, if you're living with Karen, I thought..."
She stopped, as if against the wall of her own awkwardness. Her eyes darted downward quickly, then back up to him.
"I didn't mean to suggest that..."
"Are you here on business?" Frank asked crisply.
"Well, as a matter of fact, I am,"
Amelia said, now suddenly very formal.
"Last night at Karen's, Zach mentioned that you were a private investigator."
"That's right."
"Well, I think that's what I need."
Frank stepped around her and headed toward his desk.
"Okay," he said. "Come in."
The air inside the office was still faintly musty, and Amelia sniffed at it uncomfortably as she closed the door behind her.
"Have you been here long?" she asked after a moment.
"A few months."
"And before that you were a policeman?"
"Yes."
She glanced silently about the room, and from the look in her eyes Frank couldn't tell whether she approved or not, but only that some final judgment was being made. After a moment she looked back at him.
"It looks like a place where a secret would be safe," she said.
Frank sat down behind his desk and lit a cigarette.
"What can I do for you, Miss Cavallo?" he asked.
Emilia slipped into the rickety wooden chair which rested a few feet from Frank's desk.
I don't exactly know where to begin, she said. It was such a shock.
She nodded toward the half-empty pack of cigarettes on Frank's desk.
May I have one? She asked.
Frank slid the pack over to her. Emilia lit the cigarette and sat back slightly in her seat.
Obviously, I've never dealt with anything like this before.
What is it exactly? Frank asked immediately. Once again, Emilia seemed to hesitate slightly, as if she could not get to the words she needed.
Well, she said finally, I suppose you could say that it's about murder.
Suddenly, a high, trembling laugh broke from her.
Sorry, she said quickly as she broke it off. It's an odd problem I have, nervous laughter.
She shook her head angrily.
I hate it. It makes me look like a hysteric.
Frank leaned toward her slightly. Who was murdered, Miss Cavallo?
A woman,
Emilia told him.
A woman named Carlsberg, Hannah Carlsberg.
A relative?
No, an employee.
Frank took out a small green notebook, flipped to the first page, and wrote Hannah Carlsberg's name at the top. When did this happen?
2 weeks ago.
Where?
Here in New York, Emilia said. 76th Street. You may have read about it. It was in the Post, but I don't think it made the Times.
What was the address?
357 Central Park West.
Do you know the time?
Early in the morning, Emilia said. That's all I can tell you.
And you said she was an employee of yours, Frank said.
Yes.
What do you do? Frank asked. Emilia smiled quietly.
You don't know.
Frank shook his head.
I'm a designer, Emilia explained. I don't want to sound arrogant, but the truth is I'm very well known.
What do you design?
Clothes. Very fine clothes.
Frank wrote it down. And what did Miss Carlsberg do for you?
She worked for me in several different ways, Emilia said. She'd been doing it for many years.
She took a long draw on the cigarette, then blew a thin column of smoke into the air.
Many years, she repeated, her eyes darting to the left. There's no calendar on your wall. Don't you need a calendar?
How many years? Frank asked. Emilia hesitated slightly.
Does that matter?
I'd like to know as much as I can, Frank explained. Suddenly, Emilia looked reassured.
Yes, of course, I'm sorry.
She took another long draw on the cigarette.
Hannah was a very valuable employee. She had worked for me for over 20 years.
As what?
First as a seamstress, then later as a floor manager. For the last 10 years, she'd been my most important assistant.
Frank wrote it down quickly, then looked back up at Emilia. This next question may seem a little strange, but it's important. Emilia stiffened slightly, as if bracing herself against it. Is there any doubt that it was a homicide? Frank asked. I mean, could she have killed herself, something like that?
Hannah was slashed to death, Mr. Clemons, Emilia said darkly. She didn't do that to herself.
Suddenly, Frank felt his fingers squeezing more tightly around the pen, felt its point bearing down more firmly on the page as his energy began to flow through it, building steadily with each passing second, the way it always did when suddenly, from out of nowhere, something mattered. Then the police have been looking into it, Frank said.
Yes.
Have they talked to you?
Yes, several times.
About what?
Just if I knew anything about Hannah, Emilia said. Which I really didn't. She kept to herself. That's just the way she was.
Do you have any idea about what the police think?
None whatsoever, Emilia said. I guess they're a little like Hannah. They keep things to themselves.
But have they told you anything at all about their investigation?
Only that nothing was missing from Hannah's apartment.
Did she have anything worth stealing? Frank said. Not everybody does.
Well, she had jewelry, Emilia said,
and I don't mean the sort of junk you buy at Woolworth's. Her jewelry box was open, but nothing had been taken.
How about a safe?
The police didn't mention it. I don't think she had one.
Frank took a map of New York City and spread it out across his desk. It was a police sector map, and it indicated that Hannah's address was in the Midtown North precinct.
Do you know who's in charge of the case? He asked.
Quite a few policemen came marching through my office, Amelia said. They have a way of all looking the same. She smiled. It's those polyester jackets.
Then the smile vanished, her face softened, and her voice took on a gentle, apologetic quality.
I don't mean to be snide, I really don't. It's just that Hannah was very loyal to me, and I want her to have a decent burial.
Burial?
Yes.
She's not been buried? Frank asked unbelievingly.
No,
Amelia said.
And that's why I've come to you.
Frank looked at her, puzzled.
The police won't release the body until a relative claims it, Amelia explained.
Did Miss Carlsberg have any relatives?
I don't know, Amelia told him. That's what I want you to find out.
She shifted uneasily in her chair.
She mentioned a sister once. Maybe she had a sister, I don't know.
Frank wrote it down and glanced back up at Amelia.
Do you have any idea why the police are trying to hold on to the body?
No.
Have you asked them to release it?
Yes, of course, right away.
And what did they say?
That for now they required a relative, Amelia said. Otherwise they won't release it.
Who's in charge of the case?
A man named Tannenbaum, I think, Amelia said. At least, he's the one I've spoken to a few times.
She looked suddenly puzzled.
They wanted to know if Hannah had any enemies at work, things like that. They wanted to know what she did at work, who she knew at work. That's what Mr. Tannenbaum was always talking about.
Leo Tannenbaum.
That sounds right, Amelia said. Do you know him?
We've had some contact, Frank told her without elaborating.
It had been a missing person case. Kidnapping was suspected, maybe murder. Frank had talked to a few people in Midtown North, Tannenbaum among them. A few weeks later, the missing person had turned up again with a trunk full of souvenirs he'd bought in Honolulu.
Anyway, that's the name, I believe, Amelia said. We spoke a few times. He seemed to be in charge of everything, the whole investigation, I mean.
Sounds like he asked the usual questions.
Amelia shrugged.
I suppose so, she said. But he kept looking at me like he hated me, like he wanted to hurt me in some way.
Why would he want that?
I don't know, Amelia said quietly. I really don't.
She took a quick puff on the cigarette.
I told him that Hannah worked for me, but that I didn't know her that well. What else could I say? It was the truth.
And so you couldn't help them?
I don't think so,
Amelia said. She shook her head.
I didn't know much about Hannah's personal life. She was an employee. I was her, well, her boss. You know what that is. You don't always have any other kind of relationship.
She shrugged helplessly.
She'd worked for me for a long time. At this point, I only want her to have a decent burial. I think she deserves that.
She took a final drag on the cigarette and snuffed it out in the small tin ashtray on Frank's desk.
This really isn't a personal thing,
she added as her eyes shot up to him.
She wasn't my surrogate mother or anything like that. She was a very valuable employee, and because of that, I don't want the police to keep her body locked up in the morgue.
They may have their reasons, Miss Cavallo, Frank told her.
Amelia stared at him icily.
If they have such compelling reasons, then why won't they tell me what they are?
I don't know, Frank admitted, but I don't think they'd hold on to it for no reason at all.
Perhaps, Amelia said, as if giving in to his professional judgment. But I have no confidence in the police, Mr. Clemons. Frank,
She looked at him closely.
May I call you Frank?
He nodded. Emilia smiled slightly.
As far as I know, they've made absolutely no progress in finding whoever it was who killed Hannah.
You haven't given them much time.
2 weeks, Emilia said with a sudden sharpness. It's disrupting everything.
Disrupting?
My life, Emilia said. The people who work for me, do you think they like being questioned? This has been going on for 2 weeks. How much longer will it take to put Hannah to rest?
Miss Cavallo, if a murder isn't solved in 24 hours, it may not be solved for years. It may never be solved.
Are you saying that you don't want the job? Emilia asked bluntly.
No, Frank said. But if you wait a few more days, you might save yourself some money.
I don't care about your fee, Mr. Clemons, Emilia said softly. I can afford it.
She glanced away from him, as if in an effort to control herself.
I just want Hannah to have a decent burial. That's all I want.
Frank closed the notebook. All right, he said. I'll do what I can. Emilia turned back toward him, and for a moment an odd pleading quality came into her face. Then, in an instant, she swept it out again and stared at him stiffly, her head lifted slightly in an attitude of hard command.
I hope you can help me. Please try.
I can only let you know what I find out, Frank replied firmly. I can't do more than that.
Money is no object.
That may be true, Frank said, but if you start spreading too much of it around, you'll start buying lies. Emilia did not seem convinced.
I just want you to know that whatever it costs, I'll pay it, she said.
Then she stood up and walked to the door. I'll talk to Tannenbaum, Frank called to her. I'll let you know what I find out.
I'd like to be able to reach you, too, Emilia said. When you're not here, I suppose I can reach you at Karen's?
Most of the time.
Anywhere else? Emilia asked.
She smiled tentatively.
Some private haunt?
I go to a little after-hours drinking place sometimes, Frank told her reluctantly.
Telephone number?
Emilia asked matter-of-factly. Not for this kind of place. Emilia's eyes darted away from him shyly.
I guess I don't know much about places like that, she said, embarrassed.
It's at the corner of 10th Avenue and 50th Street, Frank said. Second floor. It's open from 2 until dawn.
I'd only come in some sort of emergency, Emilia assured him.
Then she allowed her eyes to wander over his office once again, her head turning slowly to the left so that her face was caught suddenly in the dusky light.
This place, she said. It's like a cave. Like a room in the underworld.
Then she turned abruptly and walked away. Chapter 4. The large brick facade of the Midtown North Precinct House sat in the middle of the street, huge and unmoving, like a gigantic red watchdog. Blue and white patrol cars lined the sidewalks left and right, along with several police scooters and an array of unmarked cars, usually dark blue or dark green, all of them bearing a police code on their license plates, which identified them almost as clearly as their dusty, unwashed black wall tires. A long wooden desk stretched for nearly the entire width of the front room, and several people stood at various points along its length, some staring sourly at the bleak world which surrounded them, their hands cuffed behind their backs, their upper arms grasped loosely by the cops who stood next to them. To the right, a continuous stream of people moved in and out of the building. Cops, witnesses, complainants, women with black eyes and broken arms, pimps, and gamblers in bright-colored jackets, chubby, middle-aged detectives who ponderously mounted the stairs toward the separate units of vice, narcotics, and homicide. To his right, Frank could see several wooden benches, and as he stood waiting to get the desk sergeant's attention, he allowed his eyes to move over the people who occupied them. A skinny junkie nodded half-consciously at the far end of the bench, her pale, washed-out face slumping more and more deeply forward until she finally caught herself and jerked backward abruptly. An old woman sat next to her, obliviously riffling through a suitcase at her feet. It was filled with a thick pile of sodden magazines, and the woman was carefully going through them, slowly peeling back one page at a time. Down the line, a well-dressed man stared vacantly toward the opposite wall. The collar of his shirt was torn, as well as the left knee of his trousers, and he looked as if the street mugging he just suffered had irrevocably changed the way he saw the world, invested it with a capacity of unimaginably sudden danger. "Hello, Clemons." Frank turned toward the desk sergeant. His name was Calvino, and he ran the desk like a ringmaster, moving frantically from one knot of people to the next, answering the phone, screaming commands through the small brown speakers that hung here and there throughout the building. "Is Tannenbaum in?" Frank asked. "Yeah, upstairs. He's still working on the Hannah Carlsberg case." "Far as I know," Calvino said. His eyes scanned the scarred double doors of the precinct. Three men had just slammed through them, followed closely by three times as many cops. "Shit," Calvino hissed. "It's a paper storm today." His eyes shot over to Frank. "Upstairs," he said hastily. "Tannenbaum's up there somewhere." Frank made his way up the creaking wooden staircase which led to the second floor. The railing had been smoothed down by the thousands of hands that had grasped it, and the steps sloped downward at the center. A steady stream of people had moved up and down this single staircase, and as he made his way toward the top, Frank could feel an odd kinship with all of them. Not only the weary cops who had tramped up to their desks, but the people they'd pushed ahead of them or pulled up from behind, murderers and arsonists, drunks and thieves. That sea of felons whose murky depths, it seemed to him, knew no restraining tide, but whose disordered lives struck him as deeply interwoven with his own, part of some thin, tenuous connection which still drew him to the world. Tannenbaum was sitting at his desk in the homicide bullpen, a daily news spread out before him. He wore an expensive jacket and shiny leather shoes, and because of them, Frank assumed that the Internal Affairs Division had been over his books more than once, found nothing, and so now assumed that he was simply one of those people who preferred a suit from Paul Stewart and shoes from Botticelli to a week in the Bahamas or a narrow little house on Staten Island. "Hello, Leo," Frank said as he stepped up to the desk. Tannenbaum glanced up from his paper, then back down at it. "Did you read this, Frank? Last night in Queens, two cops shot each other. Lovers, can you believe it? Both of them married. God knows how many kids between them." He looked at Frank. "It's the sort of thing that makes my heart sore. What about you?" Frank drew a chair over to Tannenbaum's desk and sat down. "A couple of weeks ago, a woman was killed up on 76th Street," he said. "Her name was Hannah Carlsberg." "That's right. You still work in that case?" "Well, it's way too early to close it, Frank."
"Are you in charge of it?"
"More or less," Tannenbaum said. "Why?"
"I've been asked to look into it," Frank told him.
"Really?" Tannenbaum said. "Who asked you to do that?"
"A paying customer," Frank said.
Tannenbaum laughed. "Come on, Frank. This isn't television. Cops and PIs work together, you know that." He smiled thinly. "Let's face it, you can't do much without us, at least not when we're talking about murder." He winked playfully. "But hey, give the devil his due, you know. I mean, when it comes to catching some politico in his girlfriend's undies, you guys have it all over us." Frank said nothing, and so Tannenbaum continued, happily shooting one finger after another into the air as he ticked off the singular disadvantages of a private investigator who chooses not to share his information with the police. I love reminding you guys that you don't have a crime lab. You don't have a fingerprint file. You can't do ballistics, run hair and fiber samples, or put so much as a fingernail clipping under the infrared. I hate to tell you, but you can't swab a vagina for semen or trace the blood type of the freak who put it there. You can't do soil chemistry, Frank, or footprint molds, or work up a composite of the human face. He leaned forward. Am I making my point? Frank stared at him expressionlessly. You can't do autopsies, work up psychological profiles, or look into anybody's past by way of our computers, Tannenbaum continued authoritatively. Then he stared evenly into Frank's eyes. So what it all adds up to is this. When it comes to a murder case, you need me a hell of a lot more than I need you.
Cavallo, Frank said. Emilia Cavallo.
She's her client.
Yes.
Tannenbaum smiled. That's what I figured. He leaned back in his chair. And so she figures you can call her the guy who killed Miss Carlsberg.
She only wants you to release the body, Frank told him, so the woman can have a decent burial.
Anything else?
No.
She's not interested in who killed her.
She's leaving that to you.
Tannenbaum nodded. Well, it's understandable, her concern. About burying her friend, I mean. I don't like keeping bodies in the cooler myself. What else did she have to say?
Just what the police told her.
Which was?
That you didn't want to release the body, Frank said. And that you didn't have to unless a relative demanded it.
That's a law, Frank, Tannenbaum said. Did she say anything else?
That Carlsberg was a loyal employee.
And she wants you to find a relative, right?
Yes.
Tannenbaum shrugged. Okay, he said. Maybe I can help you.
He took a manila folder from the top drawer of his desk and shoved it into his jacket pocket.
Come on, let's go for a walk, he said as he stood up briskly. I could use a street dog.
Once outside the precinct house, Tannenbaum turned up toward 9th Avenue, then headed north toward Central Park.
Precinct atmosphere's beginning to get on my nerves, Frank, he explained. Did that ever happen to you?
All the time.
I can take the streets, but the cop house is a sewer, Tannenbaum added. Was it like that in Atlanta?
It's always like that if you have a taste for working alone.
Tannenbaum took a deep, relaxing breath. When are you going to get rid of that hillbilly accent? I figured that'd be history by now.
Things cling, Frank said.
You should hear my brother-in-law, Tannenbaum said. Sounds just like a goddamn redneck, he laughed. He tells me you guys have a liquor down there named Rebel Yell. Is that true?
Yeah.
Can you get it up here?
Never tried.
Tannenbaum looked at him seriously. What? You don't get sentimental about the old home place? Frank said nothing, and the two of them walked silently to Columbus Circle. Tannenbaum bought a Frank from a street vendor, then strolled over to one of the benches at the edge of the park and sat down.
He lifted the hot dog slightly before taking the first bite.
I'd miss these, he said.
Frank leaned back on the bench beside him. A young woman walked by quickly, then darted into the street. She reminded him of Karen's sister, and for a moment he wanted to run after her, warn her, say the one thing he'd always wanted to say to his own daughter. Be whatever you like, but do not be a victim. Tannenbaum took a sip from a can of soda, then carefully wiped the corners of his mouth with a napkin.
I hear you live with a pretty classy woman, he said.
Frank continued to watch the young woman as she threaded her way through the thickening traffic.
Does she know Cavallo?
Tannenbaum asked. Yes. So, this business between you and Cavallo, it's strictly professional?
Yes, it is, Frank said coolly.
Hey, I gotta ask, Frank,
Tannenbaum said almost apologetically.
If you're going to be in on this case, I don't want any secrets between us.
She came to me this morning, Frank said. She was at a party at Karen's last night. I'd never seen her before. Does that satisfy you?
No problem, Frank, believe me, Tannenbaum said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.